Hello, this is Little Green Ghouls, and welcome back to Goosebumps Revisited, a series where I break down a classic Goosebumps book and any episode that goes along with it. I will also be totaling up some of our Goosebumps cliches and classic moments. This week, I'm excited to visit The Haunted School. This was one of the last Goosebumps books I remember checking out from the library as a kid, and although I couldn't remember the specifics of the story, I did remember it being one of the scarier books, and it turns out that's still pretty true. Stein put some effort into creating an unsettling atmosphere with a maze of a school and some genuinely disturbing imagery involving a darkness-worshipping child cult. This is a must-read if you never got around to this one. The 1997 cover actually gives quite a few clues towards what the story is going to entail, with a pile of black and white school supplies and gray eyes peering out of the darkness. The cover feels Scream-inspired to me, with just a flash of some scared-looking eyes. It's a pretty solid cover overall, but not one of my favorites. The 2005 Slime border color pairing switches from green and yellow to gray and green, and I'm just not crazy about either of these sets, to be honest. As per usual with these later books, this book is featured in a trading card book tear out, and this week I did find a Haunted School t-shirt from PacSun that I doubt is from the 90s, but it was still nice to find something to include. In the back of the book, we have a promo for three upcoming Goosebumps books, and what's fun about this one is it features the planned title for Werewolf Skin, which was I Wanna Be a Werewolf for Halloween, which is a terrible title. Werewolf Skin is way better. On the next page, we have a Goosebumps book and a stocking pack where you get more and more and more tales to give you Goosebumps. It took me way too many tries to say that correctly. It also came with a special Goosebumps Christmas stocking, and I had trouble finding a picture of the stocking itself, and I'm somewhat certain it looks like this, but take it with a grain of salt because I found it on eBay. This book is extra thick, and in the very back of the book we find out why. Usually each book contains a couple chapters from the next Goosebumps book, but this one had 33 pages from the Goosebumps triple header, which contained three stories hosted by Lefty, Righty, and Slim, the monsters from the cover. There are two of these books, and Stein wrote a third, but it was never released, allegedly due to his fallout with Scholastic. Our front take says, "They're watching you learn the hard way," which is pretty creative as far as our front takes usually go. Our back take says, "He's hearing voices from another world," which gives a nice clue to what the plot of this book has in store, but let's check out the blurb on the back. Tommy Fraser's dad just got married. Now Tommy's got a new mom, and he's going to a new school, Bell Valley Middle School. Tommy doesn't hate school, but it's hard making friends, and his new school is so big it's easy to get lost, which is exactly what happens. Tommy gets lost, in a maze of empty classrooms, and that's when he hears the voices, kids' voices crying for help, voices coming from behind the classroom walls. This blurb doesn't even scratch the surface of what's in this book, but let's start the summary. The book opens with our introduction to Tommy Fraser, who's just been concussed via fall from a ladder. He hit the ground and rattled his brains on the floor, which potential book frenemy Ben thinks was hilarious. Tommy's on the school dance decorating committee at his new middle school and is trying his best to make a good impression, but it's not going well. At this dance committee, we're also introduced to Thalia, whose oddly specific character trait is that she applies a ton of makeup, to the point other kids tease her for it. Tommy doesn't mind that she looks like the result of Homer's makeup gun though, and thinks she's great just for acknowledging he exists. Ben appears to be our agent of chaos in this book, because a couple paragraphs after the ladder incident, he gets reprimanded by the principal for painting the slogan, "Dance till you puke," on some signs. He has to switch them to "Welcome everyone," which is way less exciting. The kids realize they need some more paint and send Tommy to the third floor art room to retrieve some. This school must be massive because Tommy requires detailed instructions to locate it. Tommy also wants to impress Thalia, so he uses some middle school boy logic and runs really fast out of the gym to get the paint. Unfortunately for him, and even more unfortunately for some random girl, he crashes into her full speed and knocks her to the ground, resulting in her head making a loud crack as it hit the concrete floor. We're just handing out concussions left and right in this book. The girl's about a foot taller than Tommy, and is pissed because his stupid ass really could have hurt her. He notes her scary steel gray eyes, which I'm mostly pointing out because of the cover. Then we have a chapter cliffhanger where Tommy is frantically asking what she's gonna do to him. This goes nowhere though, and the mystery girl just storms up the stairs. Tommy is rattled though, and has shaky legs as he continues up the stairs. You'd think she was the one that cracked his head on the concrete with the way this boy's acting. Tommy spends the next few pages wandering around the creepy empty school hallways before reaching the art room. Outside the door he thinks he hears voices, but when he enters no one is in there. It happens again when he's in the art closet, but when he pops out he still sees no one. He tries to follow the voices to random rooms down the hall, but once again still sees nothing. He vaguely feels like the voices are calling for help, but they sound muffled and far away. At this point he's equally creeped out, and also wondering if the fall from the ladder did actual brain damage. Stein's putting some real effort into making these voices in empty classrooms unsettling, and it's a nice change of pace. The chapter ends with an ominous shadow appearing in the doorway, but this just ends up being a custodian walking around with an unlit cigar in his mouth. Tommy sneaks by undetected and then gets himself lost as he makes his way back to the gym. It's not really his fault though, because this school sounds confusing as hell. He ends up in a stairway that only goes down one flight, and then down a somewhat abandoned looking hallway. He reaches the edge and he finds a boarded up doorway. Tommy then just ends up pulling random doors open in search of an exit, when he is startled to find a room full of kids just staring at him in another chapter cliffhanger. These end up being statues dressed in 1940s school kid outfits. These statues are made out of some weird lifelike plaster, and instead of getting the hell out of there, Tommy busts out his grandfather's lighter, which he carries around for good luck apparently, and gets extra close to these creepy mannequins. The statues are extremely detailed, and Tommy can't figure out why the hell they'd be in an empty classroom. He reads a plaque that says Class of 1947, when one of the statues startles him by calling out, "What are you doing here?" in another chapter cliffhanger. This is obviously too soon in the book for something like this to happen, so it just ends up being the principal, Ms. Borden. She informs Tommy that this is the entrance to the old school building, and that this is a private sad room. This just confuses Tommy further, and we learn that the statues were built in honor of the class of 1947, who all just vanished into thin air one day. The town boarded up the school and eventually built a new school around it. That doesn't sound very practical, but it makes for an unsettling setting, I suppose. Miss Borden leads Tommy back to the gym, but when he enters, he's horrified to find Thalia and Ben sprawled face down on the gym floor in yet another chapter cliffhanger. The kids are just playing a prank though, because they got so bored waiting for Tommy to return. Thalia again starts applying more makeup, so there's clearly going to be something going on with this plot-wise later on. Ben declares they'll finish painting tomorrow and takes off out of the gym. Tommy updates Thalia on his little adventure to the art room, and we learn that the girl he ran into is named Greta, and Thalia warns him to watch out for her. He then tells her about the mystery voices in the art room, which causes Thalia to suddenly tear up and race out of the gym. We then jump a few days later to a classroom scene, where the teacher leaves the room and the kids go wild. One kid even busts out a boombox because it's the 1990s. During the chaos, Thalia is once again putting on lipstick. At this rate, this girl must be ingesting a tube of lipstick a day. Actually, since it's the 1990s, I wonder if it's those lip smacker chapsticks that smell delicious, and I definitely didn't taste multiple times, because at least then I could understand this girl's obsession. Greta appears on the scene and snatches Thalia's lipstick, which results in a game of keep away. Thalia's reaction though is a little intense as she goes primal trying to get the lipstick back. Tommy decides to save the day and demands Greta drop the lipstick. He's about to get pounded by Greta when the teacher returns and everybody scurries back to their seats to act like nothing was happening. The class starts silent reading time, where Tommy suddenly hears a girl faintly calling for help. He looks around the room and no one else seems to hear it. After a third cry for help, he finally asks the class if anybody heard that, but they're all like, nope. And then the teacher mocks him for hearing voices. The story then jumps to the night of the dance, and I literally just watched 1976's Carrie last night, so I'm immediately on edge about the school dance. Also, side note, while I was watching that movie, I kept thinking horror needs to have a bright color renaissance. Give me style over realism any day. Anyways, this school goes all out for their dances. They even have a band called Grunt that consists of 5 guitar players and Greta as the drummer. Miss Borden stops by to admire the gym decorations, which the kids are still trying to finish up. She then instructs Tommy to take some pictures with her Polaroid before all the other students arrive. Ghosts and cameras don't mix well, so we'll see where this goes. While Tommy is busy taking photos, Greta accidentally smashes through one of their painted banners, so Ben and Tommy have to race up to the art room to find tape. This is presented as quite the crisis, and it takes them a bit to remember the existence of scotch tape. Tommy for some reason decides to lead the way and argues with Ben about the quickest way to get to the art room, which results in the two boys getting lost and ending up outside the boarded entrance to the old school. Ben somehow ends up tumbling through the old rotted boards, and when Tommy excitedly declares they're inside the old school, Ben trots out Stein's patented personal slang, thrills and chills. They wander around for a bit, and Tommy is still stoked that they're probably the first kids to explore these halls since they were closed 50 years ago. They reach an elevator, and Tommy wants to take it to the third floor, and both kids are surprised when the elevator doors open. These two dumbasses actually go inside of it, because to them, what's the worst thing that could happen by riding in a 50-year-old elevator that hasn't been maintained? I clearly have no sense of adventure because I already have limited trust with regular elevators. We then spend an entire chapter with these two boys clicking buttons in the non-functioning elevator. Like Stein literally describes Tommy pressing every single button multiple times for pages trying to get it to go. It eventually occurs to them that the doors aren't opening even when they press the open button and they realize they're trapped. Panic naturally sets in and they start screaming for help before trying the emergency red button at the top. My claustrophobic ass would be clawing those doors open. The emergency red button doesn't set off an alarm. Instead, the elevator starts to hum and Tommy realizes they're now moving sideways instead of up and down, like it's a Willy Wonka elevator. The elevator finally comes to a halt and the doors open. Tommy and Ben hop out of the elevator quickly into total darkness. They run their hands along the wall looking for a light switch, but they can't seem to find anything. When they return to the elevator, they're horrified to discover there's no elevator button, so now they're just locked out in total darkness. Tommy decides they need to keep searching for some sort of exit, so they scoot against the wall into the darkness, hoping they can find a classroom or something with a light in it. While scooting along, Tommy hears a cough and some whispers and a chapter cliffhanger, as he and Ben realize they're not alone in the darkness. Stein is again doing a nice job building up suspense. I don't know the last time one of his books made this much of an effort to be creepy. The lights suddenly somewhat flash on, and Tommy and Ben can see they're in a classroom, but everything is washed in gray, like they're trapped in a black and white film. Tommy then spots a girl peeking out from behind a cabinet. The girl is entirely gray, with gray eyes, hair, lips, and clothes. Four more kids appear behind her, and they're also all gray. The gray kids then swarm Ben and Tommy in a chapter cliffhanger, as they think they're about to be torn apart, because the gray kids keep yanking at all their clothes. One of the boys screams stop, and all the gray kids settle down. It turns out they weren't trying to hurt Ben or Tommy, they were just excited to see color for the first time in 50 years. This leaves Tommy confused, because he's unaware he's in a book titled The Haunted School, though he's not jumping to ghostly conclusions. One of the gray kids appears to be the leader, and introduces himself as Seth. He tries to get Ben and Tommy to sit down so they can explain the situation, but they're not having it and try to escape, only to find that the doors are locked. Seth finally convinces the boys to calm the fuck down and listen. He explains they're no longer in the school, but are on the other side of the wall. Seth then goes on to say they're from the original class of 1947, and that the elevator must be a connection between the two worlds because no one has ever arrived by elevator before. We're then given a backstory on these gray kids. An evil photographer named Mr. Chameleon was hired to take a class photo for school picture day. Mr. Chameleon hated kids, but was the only photographer in town. Mr. Chameleon took their picture, but when the flash went off, it was incredibly bright, and when they all opened their eyes, they were trapped in Gray World, which appears to be like living in an old photograph. So it's looking like we have another cursed camera situation going on here. Someone better tell Greg. Seth finishes up his story, and Tommy glances at his hands and starts shrieking because his hands are slowly turning gray. This sends Ben and Tommy spiraling as they search the room for a way out. It seems like they're confined to the classroom where the photo was taken, aside from the elevator doors near the back of the class. Tommy and Ben try and fail to pry the elevator doors open, and the great kids say those doors hadn't opened in 50 years until tonight. Tommy then spots a window and decides to crawl out of it. The five great kids warn them not to go out there, because the other 20 great kids have gone insane and will take them to the pit. Tommy and Ben ignore these warnings and jump out of the window into blackness. They hit the ground with a thud and notice the night sky has no stars or moon, so I'm a little confused on what the light source is. They run to the neighborhood across the street, but it's unfamiliar, and it starts to sink in that they're in a different world and maybe should have listened to the gray kids' warnings. They wander for a bit before realizing this was a terrible idea and they're probably further away from their own world than ever. Everything is covered in a strange gray fog, so they're unsure exactly how to get back to the school. They settle on entering one of these abandoned houses and sleep in there for the night. This is all kind of reminding me of the Upside Down in Stranger Things. Just before Tommy enters the house, he's suddenly knocked to the ground with a screech and a chapter cliffhanger. This ends up just being a lame cat jump scare fakeout. It's a short fakeout though, because one page later, a voice shouts from the fog, "Over here, don't let them get away." The boys are then surrounded by mystery gray fog children. The fog children start circling around Ben and Tommy while shouting, "Turn, turn, turn," over and over. They do a weird little dance while chanting, and this goes on for three pages before it occurs to Tommy that they want to trap them in this world and turn them gray. I'm not sure why he needed three pages for this to sink in, it's pretty straightforward. Tommy decides their only hope of escape is to catch the fog kids by surprise, head separate directions, and bust through the circle. When has splitting up ever been a good idea? This doesn't really matter though, because when they go to run, Tommy has a leg spasm and immediately falls to the ground, leaving poor Ben to get launched right back into the circle. The kids are chanting, "Turn to gray, turn to gray," while also listing things that no longer have color, like the moon, stars, or their own dreams. The gray kids then start to drag Tommy and Ben towards the black pit, which they plan on tossing the boys in. The book then gets a little unhinged, as we have a scene where the fog kids bring over a mysterious bubbling black liquid that stinks like dead animals and begin guzzling it down. They get wild with the black liquid, spitting it in the air and in each other's faces as they declare things like, "Drink the blackness," and, "We cover ourselves in blackness because there is no color in the moon." It feels like a full-on suicide cult. Like, there are multiple paragraphs of these kids just spitting black liquid all over each other, and it's just fucking weird. The cult kids lead Ben and Tommy to the edge of the pit, which is full of this boiling black liquid, which Ben again remarks smells like dead animals. The kids continue spitting black goo in the air and on each other when the chapter ends with Tommy getting shoved into the pit. Except not really, it's Seth who has his hands on Tommy. The nice gray kids from earlier have come to rescue them. The five nice gray kids race away with Tommy and Ben, but they don't get far before the 20 cult kids circle them all up again. This is when Tommy remembers his lighter and busts out the fire. the flame of the lighter freaks the cult kids out because they think it's too bright. I was kind of wondering why he didn't use this lighter way back in the elevator scene. Tommy then lights a pile of leaves on fire, which really freaks out the cult kids and they all scramble away in different directions. This gives Tommy and Ben a chance to escape back to the school with the nice gray kids. Once in the school, they're horrified to see that they're both entirely gray, except for their noses and cheeks. They're feeling defeated when Seth casually mentions that one gray child escaped to the other side just a few weeks ago, but no one knows how. Seth probably should have delivered this information sooner. Tommy immediately thinks it must be Greta with her strange gray eyes and love for black clothing. But let's be real, it's a red herring and it's obviously Thalia and her makeup obsession. They all sit in miserable silence for a bit before Tommy has an idea. He thinks the lighter could wash away the gray and maybe allow them to escape into the color world. This doesn't really make sense and lasts two chapters and goes nowhere because the lighter is out of fluid actually. Ben and Tommy's noses are the only thing left in color and they're feeling hopeless when the elevator doors spring open revealing Greta. Nope, it's Thalia, because duh. Thalia is stoked that she found the boys and is happy to see her old friends, so happy in fact that she just lets the elevator door slam shut behind her. Thalia then goes on to explain the obvious. She escaped a few weeks ago and has been using makeup and contact lenses to cover up her grayness. Other details of how she manages to exist in a world where she has no parents or resources is not explained. Thalia says she didn't know how to find her way back to the gray world until she found the abandoned elevator, but she actually doesn't want to return to the real world anymore because she's happy in gray world where she belongs. This really doesn't help out Tommy and Ben's current situation though. She even ends the chapter being like, "Sorry, I can't help you guys." Tommy states that they really don't want to be in gray world, and then Thalia is like, "Oh, my bad, I forgot to tell you. I do actually know how to help you escape." She then goes on to say she found a tube of unopened lipstick in her bag. After 50 years of being trapped in a classroom with nothing to do, there is no way this girl never checked her bag, but whatever. The lipstick hadn't changed to gray, so she felt compelled to draw on the wall with it, and was surprised the color burned right through the gray wall and led to the real world. Thalia then quickly draws a window on the wall, so Tommy and Ben can crawl through it. None of the other kids want to come with them because they don't think they'll be happy in the real world anymore. This makes zero sense because there is no way the gray world, with a cult of wild darkness worshipping children, is better than feeling mildly out of place in the real world. But this doesn't matter, Tommy and Ben are now safely back in the real world. This safety is short-lived though, because two pages later they're confronted by Miss Borden, who wants them to join the group dance committee photo, and in a final page twist, Mr. Chameleon takes the boys' photo before they can stop him, so that's how this one ends. Rather abruptly, with quite a few loose ends if you think too much about it. The Haunted School didn't get a direct episode pairing, but there is an episode called The Perfect School, which I chose because why not? They both have to do with schools. Perfect School is a short story from Even More Tales to give you goosebumps, so let's jump into the episode and check it out. The episode opens with voices from a vent. And maybe a home invasion? I don't know if this little plastic bat is gonna save you, kid. I had such an intense fear of burglars as a kid, this probably would have scared me. Surprise, it's just a jerk older brother.
You're home early.
This little prank got Brian sent away.
The perfect school. Why settle for anything less than perfect?
I'm including this scene just because. I feel like this should have been in military time, given the vibes they're going for. This is the perfect result of the perfect school.
Your perfect boy.
Hello, mother. Hello, father.
Is scrubbing things by toothbrush an actual thing? I feel like I see it in media often.
You still think it's not so bad?
Could be worse.
I don't think Brian is going anywhere anytime soon.
No one's escaped from the perfect school.
See, your escape was a great success.
I'd like to see you try it.
Brian is now on his second night of an attempted escape, and this episode is just kind of odd. It doesn't feel like Goosebumps to me, and I'm not getting why they felt the need to make it a two-parter.
Tissue samples.
Good, we're 20 minutes in. Maybe something can actually happen.
Your program will be accelerated starting tonight. Get him out of here.
About time we get some Goosebumps special effects. This seems like a little bit of an overreaction.
That's it!
More voices and vents.
Where are you?
Uh-oh, we got a 90s hacker on our hands here. I'm hoping for clones instead of robots.
95%.
This kid has been crawling in the vent for like 3 minutes. Everything in this episode is slow and not particularly interesting. It's like a really bad action movie, basically. Good thing the most top secret room doesn't even have a door handle.
The all clear now in section E.
Oh, yay. It is clones.
How do you know all this? I saw my clone. He's in a tank in there.
It's nice they bothered to keep the originals alive even, versus turning them into food.
You're not going anywhere.
What?
The laundry truck just left without you.
Okay, we can wrap this shit up. I think this may have been my least favorite episode so far.
Don't fight it, Brian. It's good to be perfect.
You're not going anywhere.
I can't get over the change in you. No thanks, honey, that's okay. I'll get them.
I keep telling you, the real Brian shoved me in here and took my spot.
Operation Rescue. Don't worry, guys. I'll get you out of there.
Overall, I thought the haunted school was pretty great. It has some wonky logic, but I can forgive that since Stein makes some actual effort to be scary with this one. I love the scenes with the whispering voices in the empty school, the twisting hallways, unpleasant mannequin children, and most of all, the pack of feral gray kids drinking and spitting black ooze everywhere and worshipping the darkness. I'm gonna give this one 5 out of 5 lipsticks. Sure, parts didn't really make that much sense, and the final twist is rather abrupt, but who cares, it was a good time. Okay, on to our totals. The haunted school didn't have any vomit, shoulder scares, it's only a dreams, or asshole victims, but it did have some 90s moments. In Getting Jiggy with the 90s, we had two 90s moments. These included busting out a boombox and the use of a Polaroid camera. This raises our series total to 176 jiggy 90s moments. There was just one prank in It's a Prank, Bro. This was when Ben and Thalia decided to play dead on the gym floor in order to scare Tommy. This raises our Goosebumps series total to 133 pranks. The Haunted School had a total of 14 chapter cliffhangers that were pretty decent for the most part. This raises our Goosebumps series total to 733. The clunky award this week has to go to chapters 28 to 29, where Thalia weirdly tells them she's not going to help them escape, but on the next page is like, oops, I am, I just didn't say that very clearly. It was unnecessary. Shocker ending. Our big twist to this book was almost immediately after Tommy and Ben escaped the Grey World, they're pulled into a group photo by none other than Mr. Chameleon, the evil photographer from 1947, presumably to be sucked into some other photo world. Maybe it will be in color this time. This raises our Goosebumps series total to 50. Well, that's it for The Haunted School. I really enjoyed this book, and it's kind of sad to see Stein still had some great ideas in him, only to have the series abruptly end a few books later. Does it bother anyone else this much that the series ends on book 62? It's such an ugly, random, blah number. Next week is Werewolf Skin, which I've been looking forward to since starting this series, because I remember finding the episode scary and enjoying the book. Let me know in the comments what you thought of The Haunted School. Would you drink some black goo? What did Thalia do to her gray arms and legs? Is Mr. Chameleon related to Spidey from Say Cheese and Die? Also, what did you think of my ghosty and school horror clips this week? It's kind of tricky finding good clips from ghost movies because so much of the ghosty stuff is done off camera or invisible. Anyways, as always, thanks again for watching and make sure you subscribe for
the pride, the love.